In this video, we're going to be discussing the garage management system. So the garage management system problem is similar to one of the problems in HackerRank, which we're going to be referring to right now. So let me read out the problem to you first. David has several containers, each with a number of balls in it. He has just enough containers to sort each type of ball he has into its own container. And David wants to sort the balls through using his sort method. So the garage management system and this problem are quite similar, as you can see. The garages in our system are analogous to the containers here, and the models which we talked about in the garage management system are analogous to the balls here. So moving on further with the problem, as an example, David has n is equal to 2 containers and 2 different types of balls, both of which are numbered from 0 to n minus 1. The distribution of ball types per container are described by an n cross n matrix of integers, m container and type. For example, consider the following diagram for m is equals to 1, 4, 2, 3. So if you see this diagram, there's a 2x2 matrix. Along the rows of the matrix is the ID of the containers, and along the columns is the types of the balls. So what this two-dimensional matrix will tell us is that it exactly tells us the distribution of the balls in each container. For example, if we see here, the container 0 will have one ball of type 0. Hence, there's a 1 in 0,0 entry of the matrix. And container 0 type 1 will be number 4. So that means that container 0 will contain 1 ball of type 0 and 4 balls of type 1. Similarly, container 1 will contain 2 balls of type 0 and 3 balls of type 1. Moving on further, in a single operation, David can swap 2 balls located in different containers. The diagram below depicts the swap operation. So this is exactly how the swap operation happens. This is a different case of container, same case of containers rather. And as you can see, 2 balls have been swapped. 1 from container 0 swapped with 0 from container 1, because we have to bring all the balls with the ID 0 into container 0 and all the balls with the ID 1 into container 1. So there are certain conditions as well. David wants to perform some number of swap operations such that each container contains only balls of the same type and no 2 balls of the same type are located in different containers. You must perform Q queries where each query is in the form of a matrix M. For each query, print possible on a new line if David can satisfy the conditions above for the given matrix, otherwise print impossible. So this is exactly what the problem statement is. So one condition which we have is that only 2 balls can be swapped at a time. So for example, going back to this example which we were talking about, here 1 and 0 is swapped with each other. So 1 cannot be swapped with two balls of 0 type here. That is exactly what that condition means, that only at a time only 2 balls can be swapped, similar to our models where only 2 models can be swapped from one garage to another. So since we have this condition at our hand, there's one thing which is very, very clear, that the number of balls in any container at any given time is going to remain constant. For example, if we talk about container 0, if I remove one ball, say for example ball number 1 from container 0, I will have to replace it by another ball. So the total number of count of container 0, total number of count of balls of container 0 will remain the same. So we can use this to our advantage and solve the question based on this very principle. So what we're going to have to do first is we're going to have to calculate the number of balls in each container. Say for example, here there's two different containers. So we have to calculate the number of balls in each container. So container 0 will contain 5 balls and container 1 will contain 5 balls. So that is clearly visible to the human eye here, but how are we going to tell our computer that? So we can do that by simple matrix operations. So for example, if we talk about this particular matrix, so the total number of balls in container 0 would be 1 plus 4. So to bring about this calculation in our computers, what we can do is we can keep the row number constant. We can have two for loops. In this case, we can keep the row number constant. And for example, say row number is fixed to 0, row is equals to 0. So for example, if we have two different variables, I and J, I represents the row number and J represents the column number. We can keep I fixed to 0 at the start, and we can iterate our J from 0 to 1. So, and we can add them to some variable. So this will give us the value for the number of balls in each container. So similarly, I can iterate from 0 to 1 as well for the containers 0 and 1. Let's say we have a 3 by 3 matrix. For example, there's a 3 by 3 matrix. Let's just draw one here quickly. All right, so now since there's a 3 by 3 matrix, we have three different types of balls and three different types of containers. So we have a different array as well. So we have, let's say, two arrays, one for the container and another one for the number of balls. So the container, so for example, this is 0, this is going to be 1, this is going to be 2. Similarly, this is 0, this is 1, and this is 2. So like I said, first, to calculate the amount in container 0, we keep our value I fixed to 0. So the outer for loop will be fixed to 0, and then we go to the inner for loop where j will iterate from 0 to 2. So this value plus this value is added and stored as the first entry in our first array, which is known as the, suppose the columns, so the row sum. Similarly, then we next go to the first row, and then again we repeat the same process, add these three entries courtesy to our j variable, and then store it as the second entry in our sum array. And similarly, same for the third row as well. And we have our three values depicting the number of balls which are going to be fixed in three different containers. So we need to do a similar thing on columns as well. So this is for containers. Let's denote that by C, and this is going to be for balls. Let's denote that by B. So the number of balls also is going to be constant. We are not adding or taking away any balls from the experiment. So to calculate the number of balls, we're going to have to go column wise. So again, now this time, instead of I, we basically replace I and J with each other. So instead of keeping the row constant, we're going to keep the column constant and iterate through the rows. So for example, if you have to calculate the number of balls of type 0, so first we are going to keep the j variable as 0 constant in the outer for loop, and then in the inner for loop I will iterate from 0 to 1 to 2. So number of balls in container 0 plus number of balls in container 1 plus number of balls in container 2 will give our first value, that is the number of balls of type 0. Similarly, for 1 and 2, if we do the same thing, we'll get three different values and that will form our array. So now another thing which we should notice is that since the number of balls is fixed and the number of containers, balls in a container is also fixed, the container has a certain capacity. So for example, if I want all my balls of type 0 in my container 0, the capacity of container 0 should be exactly equal to the number of balls of type 0. If we choose this case, if we take this example, it is not going to happen because the number of balls of type 0 are 3 and the capacity of container 0 is 5. Since the amount of balls in a container is going to be constant, so even if we put both these balls in this container, we'll still have two different balls of type 1 in container 0. So that is not going to satisfy a condition. So no matter how many swap operations are done on this example, it's always impossible to get our desired result. So this is exactly what we're going to do now. So just to check, for example, there's certain values here, x, and then there's a y, and then there's a z. It could be any random values. Here, for example, there's an a, and there's a b, and there's a c. So what we need to check is, for every value x, there should be an x in the c array. And for every x in a b array, there should be an x in a c array, and for every y in a b array, there should be a y in c array as well, and every z in b array, there should be a z in c array as well. So the values can be repeated as well. There can be the same number of more than one type of balls, that is okay, but as long as that value has an impression in the c array, we shouldn't have any problem. So there's various ways to do it, but one of the most simplest ways is just to sort this. So sort both these arrays and check if they're the same arrays or not. Say for example, let's take a real life literal example with actual numbers. For example, container 0 has a capacity of 3. Container 1 has a capacity of 5. And container 2 has a capacity of, let's say, 7. Okay, so that is our container. And let's now go to the balls. So we calculate the number of balls of type 0 as 3. Then type 1 as let's say 4, and type 2 as let's say 4 again. So one thing can be noticed, as far as container 0 goes, we can have balls of type 0 in container 0, so that's not a problem. But for the other two, it's going to be a problem because there's only 4 balls of type 1, but the capacity of container 1 is 5, so there has to be a foreign element present, as even if all the balls of type 1 are in container 1. So that's not going to satisfy condition. But in place, we calculate another experiment. This is B1. Let's keep C constant. We calculate B2 as, let's say, 3, 7, and 5. So what's going to happen in this case? So this is one of the situations which has arisen because of difference in calculations of the sum of respective, let's say, balls. And so that is an issue. So we are going to be misled here because the 7 and 5 have exchanged their places. So just to avoid that problem, we are going to sort this array. So if we sort this, we're going to get a 3, 5, and 7. So now that we have a 3, 5, and 7, it can be mapped exactly to this container array which we have. And in this case, it so happens that the operation which we want with our desired conditions is possible. So in this case, it is possible, but in this case, it is impossible. So this is our correct case, and this is our impossible case.